Hi, folks. It's Chris Garlock back with Michael Redmond, Nine Don Professional, our latest AlphaGo versus the world. And of course, AlphaGo undefeated so far. Not to do a little spoiler alert, but it is going to go 60-0. But our latest one, we have a return player today, don't we?
It's Lian Xiao again. He's a young Chinese player, world champion. Actually, I think he mostly won just the Chinese title. So within China, he's a very successful player, very well known, a formidable player in the world. I think he must have been at the fairly close to the top of the world rankings. And his third time, his games against AlphaGo actually were some of the most exciting for me because he does like to fight a little bit, and he's the first player where AlphaGo played that kick that we weren't supposed to play. AlphaGo seems to play a lot of the kind of taboo moves against him.
Ah, cool.
And so, yeah. In this game, Lian Xiao has black, and he's trying out two star points. And he slides. So, you know, at this point, you probably know that this is supposed to be bad.
I do.
It's not so bad when you have black, because black does have the initiative. I have the feeling that black can probably get away with this more than white can. And in this opening, just the fact that white only has a star point in the lower right corner here, and the fact that when white plays this point at h3 and gets an outside wall, white's hold on the lower side will be less secure than we were seeing in game 45, in which that was the pincer was very effective. It means that maybe black can get away with this. I didn't see a big change in the winning percentage. And so white plays here, black answers. So this is the first point where it gets exciting. We recognize white's attachment and the hane. This was a move that was played before AlphaGo. It was actually a fairly popular move. And the whole sequence here is a kind of a joseki. But actually pushing through here was the game move.
Hmm.
And it's not the move that computer programs like. So,
no.
And also, I don't really recommend this unless you're really... you really like this, Joseki. It's not the move that I would recommend. I think that black has a lot more flexibility in this case. Yeah. And in this case, you're going to see, of course, the 3-3 invasion. Like this just gets very, very modern and very unlikely that this would be played at the time of this game. Like the human player would not be diving into the 3-3 point immediately. And so I don't really think this is going to happen. You're going to see white dive into the 3-3 point too. If AlphaGo played a 3-3 point at move 16, that would be a record even for this series of games. Because I think the earliest AlphaGo played in the 3-3 point was move 19 in this series. You were really surprised. Like, why is it jumping into the 3-3 point so quickly, so early? So playing this opening is not really a realistic guess of what might have happened then. Is just a kind of a computer version. But I do think that it would be more flexible for black just to connect here. And black, if black doesn't play the 3-3 point, black does have a lot of options here. Like black could play a kakari to the lower right, or it could play play this move here, some kind of corner enclosure in the upper right. Or this kakari would work to a certain degree also. Black has a lot of options. Curling around is another option. Or playing the traditional joseki, just playing down to the second line here. That's also joseki. It would be a fairly good move. So I prefer this move, basically. I don't really care so much about what choice black makes next.
Mm-hmm.
In this game, this is also a joseki. You might remember that this is a joseki that was played in the Lee Sedol AlphaGo match. I think it was game two. The game where AlphaGo played that shoulder hit. It was
yes.
Yeah. So it is a joseki. It's a common joseki. And white, but of course the extension here is perfectly timed. At this point, white does have a slight advantage CatoGo was giving AlphaGo 52%. So with 6.5-point Komi, I've said this before, actually black starts with a very slight advantage. And so white having more than 50% means that white's gained a little bit more already. And CatoGo was saying that black is going to win by 5 points before Komi. So that's a 1.5-point win for white. And I should say it again, it's not something that I would be noticing at this point in the game. It's not, there's no way I can calculate 1.5-point difference at this point. Black plays here. This is a good looking move. And it turns out, I think Lila agreed with this move. And so this is perfectly fine. And black pushes here. Basically, black's idea is to prevent white from connecting here, make it less effective. So that was black's idea. White connects anyway.
Of course.
And this is actually where Lian Xiao, he made his first real mistake. So up to this point, black is close to 50%. And like I was saying, it's not a difference that I would be noticing. Although black has made, you could say black has made one mistake. It's not a serious mistake, if you ask me. Pushing here, it was, I can recognize that this is a mistake. And the point is that later on, white's going to be able to peep here and take away black's eye space. So playing here and inducing white to play this jump, which is a shape that white sort of wanted to play anyway, this was too direct. And it's going to be ending up, in the end, it's going to put pressure on the black group on the lower, on the left side. So black sort of covered here. And it's pretty obvious to me that I agree that this move is a much better shape. Mm. White will probably play here. Black comes down. I'm expecting this is the sequence I came out with and looks reasonable. Black has an eye on the side there. And in the process, having this stone connected up to the black group, it means that when black plays the 3-3 point here, that's going to be an attack on white on the left side. White's group on this side is not so strong either. Of course, black's weak groups, both of black's groups are not settled yet, and especially this black group is relatively weak. So white has fighting chances too, but just the fact that black has the eye and has a nice connection, this group on the left is relatively safe because it has all these stones on the fourth line. And the fact that black has that 3-3 point, the C3 point in the lower left corner to look forward to, it makes the game fairly attractive for black. I would be perfectly happy. Although CatoGo tells me white has a very slight advantage, I would be perfectly happy with black in this position. But when black pushes here, and we get to this position, and white peeps here, you know, it's just looking a bit blurring for black on the lower side. And you have to notice that now white has eye shape here. And so the 3-3 point is not nearly as effective as it was in that other variation. It's not going to be forcing anymore. So that's a big difference in this variation. And black kicks here. Now, the fun variation that I saw here was that black can actually just play away and move straight out into the center. And if white plays here, this is going to be a disaster for white, actually, because black gets to cut here. Now, if white plays this way, black has this move here, which will capture one of the two white groups. So white has to answer in the center. And this whole thing is just very bad for white. Like, black's going to live on the side. White's group here is going to lose its eye space. And black has this forcing move against the corner, which means that white has to be careful. Looks like black might be even living with sente. So this would be a complete collapse for white. Also, playing this move, something like this or like this would be even worse because black would just be playing from the center and connecting up. So black didn't even have to play this kicking move. And it was probably bad. It gave white a bit more of an advantage. At this point, the game is already 65% for white. So it's 35% for black. And CatoGo is saying that the game is close on the board. But, you know, I think a human player looking at this might have trouble seeing how that works.
I was going to say that, and just tell me if I'm wrong, because quite sure it's more than likely, but just looking at it, what, and this is just a feeling, to be honest, this is there's no reading involved, but just looking at it, and especially thanks to your, you know, great analysis, but what I'm seeing is that, yeah, black stones there just are not helping him, right? They're not attacking, they're not making any territory. And, you know, maybe it's just from having, you know, stronger players do this to me, where you just sort of feel like, you know, I'm going to have to save these stones and, you know, so what? That's what it feels like to me.
Yeah, it's just a very striking difference between this and the previous variation where Black covered here.
Yeah, yeah.
Up to this point, it's just such a better shape for Black with all those threats that Black has. But I do want to show you a bit more of the game just to show you how this works for White. White plays this exchange, and with this exchange, White was establishing the peep here. So this is going to give White a fully living shape on the left side, also taking away Black's eye space. Also, White had the threat of this push through and cut. White's planning to take those Black stones. Actually, this was the last chance for Black to keep the game relatively close by playing here and then just sacrificing. It's going to be bad for Black anyway, but this would have given Black more space on the upper side, maybe a bit better. In the game, Black got stubborn here. And this is going to be, I'm going to have fun with this in the book, I suppose. It's a kind of a strange variation, but in the end, White's going to save those stones on the upper side and capture the whole Black group there. And it's kind of being, this is just a collapse for Black. Black has lost the whole group here. You can see how suddenly everything just fell apart here for Black.
Jeez.
And White's going to run away with a leading territory after this. So I think the viewers will be convinced after they see this variation. While it was really over a lot earlier than that, like I'll go back to this point again when I'm saying that it's already good for White. And fairly, like it's close on the board, that's a big difference. But obviously, it's still, there's so much room to be played. It's difficult to see, maybe. Much more obvious as the game continues like this, and White actually massacres that Black group on the other side. And like White's winning the fight, the race to capture by about three moves. So White gets to play on the right side too. And so White has a striking lead at this point.
Wow. Yeah, and to be just so brutally manhandled, you know, when you're a top player like that, and, you know, it's with, and make it look so easy, it's just going to be a bit disconcerting, I should think.
Yeah, I think in this game, it was just that Black saw that he was behind at a certain point, and he got a bit stubborn. Like, the variation I was showing was much more, it was more reasonable, but it doesn't mean that that would give Black a favorable game at that point. It was already a difficult game for Black. And so he was trying to be a bit more aggressive. And when you do that against AlphaGo, it ends up something like this.
It's never pretty after that. All right. It's a fun one. Thank you, Michael. Thanks, everybody, for watching. And we'll see you next time.